Good morning, everybody. Good morning, Blair. It's nice to see you all here to worship and to gather and to celebrate the Christmas season. Let's stand together as we sing Angels from the Realms of Glory.
Angels from the realms of glory wing your flight o'er all the earth. Ye who sang creation's story now proclaim Messiah's birth. Come and worship, come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King. Saints before the altar bending, watching long in hope and fear. Suddenly the Lord descending in his temple shall appear. Come and worship, come and worship, worship Christ the
today to worship you, to lift your name high, and to reflect on your goodness and mercy towards us. As we spend this time worshiping and fellowshipping, we ask that your name would be praised above all else, that our hearts would be drawn into a deeper appreciation and gratitude for all that you are, and that we would be drawn deeper in our relationship with you today during this time. And we ask all of these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Why don't you greet the folks around you this morning? There's an awful lot of us. It's almost like there's something going on today. As we mentioned, we are so thankful you're able to be here this morning to gather and to worship. So glad for the Christmas season to be able to sing these songs that celebrate all that God has done in sending Christ on our behalf. So let's sing together, ring the bells on this Christmas morn, and come thou long-expected Jesus. It's is born, and the angels resound with their songs of joy. For this baby boy is the glory of heaven on earth. And the sound of Hosanna fills the sky as the Son of Heaven comes down to man. Look, our redemption drawing nigh with the birth of the great I Am. This Christmas morn, join with the angels and shepherds who gather to celebrate and annunciate the glory of heaven on earth. And the sound of Hosanna fills the sky as the Son of Heaven comes down to man. Look, our redemption drawing nigh with the birth of the great I Am. The sound of Hosanna fills the sky as the Son of Heaven comes down to man. Look, our redemption drawing nigh with the birth of the great I Am. With the birth of the great I Am. With the birth of the great I Am. Jesus, born to set thy people free, from our fears and sins release us, let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art, dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart. Born my people to deliver, born a child and yet a king, born to reign in us forever, now thy gracious kingdom bring. We recognize that he came to bring us redemption, to bring us forgiveness, and because of that, we stand here today to worship him. So let's sing together, "Here I Am," to worship.
Beauty that made altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sins upon that cross. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. So here I am to worship, here I am.
Father, we do ask that you would open our eyes to the realities of your word and that we would just continue to seek to walk in obedience to your will. In Christ's name, amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. You might notice me and Colin have both been sick the last 2 weeks. And he's having a hard time right now. So if my voice cracks while I'm doing this, my wife was making fun of me, so told me I sounded like a preteen boy all last week. So if I have to clear my throat, that's why. I'm just going to get into the announcements. I do have just a little brief letter to read. It says, with a grateful heart, I want to thank the church family for upholding Aaron, myself, and family in prayer through his cancer story. Also, we were supported by numerous Christians across this country, the U.S., and more. God's timing is always right, even when we cannot understand, but I do believe I will see him again someday. Righteous believers' prayers were answered, and we know the greatest miracle is the miracle of salvation. And that's God's blessing to all from Joanne. So just be praying for them in the passing of Aaron. Just be praying for the whole family there. I'm just going to go into the bulletin now. I'm going to highlight mostly Christmas stuff, so I'm just going to blur through the weekly things here, so just try to keep up here. Monday is WMS, and your readings are there. Tuesday is Parent and Tot Group. They're going to have their Christmas party, so I'm sure all the tots are all excited about that one. We're going to have a deacons meeting at 7 p.m. for the deacons. Just take note of that. Of course, Wednesday Bible study, and if Kids Quest and Shift are shut down for till next year, so that's all good there. So the only other thing we got is the worship team. So upcoming dates. This is an important one, I've been told, and if I don't announce it properly, Kathy's going to beat me. Is she in here? No, she's probably up getting ready. 55 plus, there is a sign-up sheet on the back table, and if you're going to be there, you need to sign it. I did my job, right, Jeff? Good, I did my job. Whew, I'm safe. All right. Also on the 17th, there is going to be a Christmas Carol sing-along at 7 p.m., and that is, it says refreshments to follow, and that is put on by WMS. It seems crazy. I've stood up here, it seems like 2 weeks ago, and I said I wasn't going to announce anything about Trunk or Treat because it was too early, but here it's Christmas. Anyway, just time keeps going. December 24th is Christmas Eve, as you all know, That is a Sunday. We will be having regular morning service and then an evening service, right? Did I get that right? I'm not confused. Good. All right. I can pat myself on the back a lot today. So we're going to be having a Christmas Eve service. Make sure you invite anybody you can think of that might want to be here or should be here. We want to pack the whole place out. So that's going to be at 6 p.m. for the Christmas Eve service. And the only other thing that I will mention is the 80th birthday celebration. There is some other birthday celebrations under 55 plus. Take note of that. But there is a special one for Margaret McCall. And there is the meal after the service for those. It says best wishes only. So the family's looking forward to having that time after the service. And I think that's all I got.
Thank you, Blair. Don't pat yourself on the back too hard, though, Brad. Come with before the fall, dude. Just be careful. I might trip you. No, I'm just like... In Psalm chapter 8, the writer is reflecting on the amazing majesty of God's creation. And he says, "When I consider the works of your hands, what is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you would look after him?" And this song, as I invite you to stand, "God with Us," sings about the beauty of Emmanuel and the fact that he would come on our behalf, and we're going to be speaking to that end this morning as we begin our series in Isaiah chapter 9. But let's stand together as we sing this, "Emmanuel, God with Us."
You would be mindful of us. What do you see that's worth looking our way? We are free in ways that we never should be. Sweet release Calvary, nevertheless.
And at this time, we'll go ahead and dismiss our younger ones on downstairs. Make sure nobody over 3 feet is trying to sneak out. You're safe, Kristen. A few people caught that. You'll have my resignation on Monday. This morning we're going to be beginning a new short series that'll take us through to Christmas Eve, through Isaiah 9, a very familiar passage when we come to Christmas time, a passage that I think we all, at least to some extent, know fairly well. And we're going to be discussing the various names of the Messiah. And we'll begin with the first of those names, the Wonderful Counselor, this morning. Earlier this week, I was reading an article. I guess it wasn't this week. It was a few weeks ago. I was reading an article that was written not too long ago. And in the article, it discussed a study that was conducted by the Angus Reid Institute back in 2002. And in this study, what they found was that 1 in 3 Canadians express at some point a need for therapy. 1 in 3 Canadians, again, this was 2002. Keep in mind everything that's kind of happened the last couple of years. I'm sure that number is pretty honest. But it said 1 in 3 Canadians have expressed the need for therapy or for counseling. And this article that I was reading was dealing with the lack of access to counseling that Canadians have right now, especially in the Atlantic region, and the stress that it's causing. And I think if we're honest with ourselves this morning, there's no shortage of calamity in our lives right now. There's no shortage of things to cause us to stress out, right? Whether it's anxiety caused by financial strain, whether it's health concerns, whether it's, you know, Christmas time, what am I going to be able to provide under the tree for my family? Regardless, I think it's safe to say that at some point we all experience anxiety and stress and concern. And whatever it is, you name it, the world seems to be in short supply of joy today. I think when we watch the news, when we look on social media, when we see what's going on in the world today, there seems to be just a stunning lack of joy. And then we come to Christmas time, which is what? It's a season that is marked with warmth and joy and celebration. And I couldn't help but notice this year that a lot of folks were putting those decorations up a whole lot earlier. You notice they seem to go up earlier each and every year. Why is that? It's because we're trying to grab at every little last bit of joy and warmth that we can add into our lives right now, because everywhere we look, there's just not a whole lot to be found. For so many, even though Christmas is a time of year that's defined by joy and warmth. This time of year is incredibly, incredibly difficult. And it's with that in mind that I wanted to go through this series. As we're going to be discussing all the way up to Christmas Eve, the hope and the joy that we have in Jesus Christ as our Savior. Yes, we talk about this every year, that Christmas is all about Christ, and it truly is. But I want us to be reflecting this year on the hope that that brings into our lives now. We sing the carols, "Come Thou Long-Expected Jesus." We think of other ones like, O Come Emmanuel. We think of this expectancy that is so attributed to this time of year. And as believers today, Christ has come. So what are we living in expectancy of? Well, his return. But we're also living in expectancy that he has a plan and a design for our lives that impacts us today. Not tomorrow, not in a few weeks. He has joy and hope to deliver into our lives today. And we're going to see that in the various names of Christ as we study through this passage in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 7. So if you have your Bibles, I'll invite you to turn there this morning, and we'll just ask the Lord to bless us now during this time. Father in heaven, we just thank you so much for your word. We thank you for the Christmas season where we get to celebrate the coming of your Son who came into the world at its lowest and darkest point to bring salvation, to bring forgiveness of sins and redemption, to bring adoption into your family. God, not because of anything that we did, but because of the riches of your grace and mercy towards us. Father, for many today, the Christmas season is not an easy season. It's a time where we think of the things that we're missing, the people that we're missing, the various stresses that are being caused in our lives. God, help us as a church family this Christmas season to have our hearts focused on you, to keep our eyes on you so that we would not lose heart in the difficulties that this world provides us, but help us to see the hope and joy that can be found in you. And as we study through this idea of you being the wonderful counselor, help us to be encouraged this morning, help us to be uplifted. And God, we just give this time to you and ask that you would speak to our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. So Isaiah chapter 9, what I want to do this morning is we're going to look at verses 1 through 7 just to kind of build up a little bit of context, my favorite word. We're going to build up just a little bit of context to this passage, and then what I want us to do is take just a few minutes to take a look at this first name, that being the name of the wonderful Counselor. But Isaiah chapter 9, I'm just going to read verses 1 through 7, and we'll kind of work our way through it. Actually, you know what? I'm going to back us up a little bit. Didn't expect that. Colin's going off-road already. We're only 5 minutes in. I want us to back up to Isaiah chapter 8, if you don't mind. And we're going to begin in verse 19, just to provide a little bit of context to the conversation here. Isaiah chapter 8, verse 19. And when they say to you, inquire of the mediums and the necromancers who chirp and mutter, should not a people inquire of their God? Should they inquire of the dead on behalf of the living? To the teaching and to the testimony. If they will not speak according to this word, it is because they have no dawn. They will pass through the land greatly distressed and hungry. And when they are hungry, they will be enraged and will speak contemptuously against their king and their God and turn their faces upward. How's that for a cheery on a Christmas Sunday? And they will look to the earth, but behold distress and darkness, the gloom of anguish, and they will be thrust into thick darkness. I'm just going to stop there just for a quick second. In Isaiah chapter 8, Isaiah is presenting to the nation of Judah the chastisement that is about to befall them. He's warning them of the impending invasion of the Assyrian army that's going to lay waste to the northern kingdom and to Judah. And this time of punishment and this time of chastening that's going to come because of the fact that the nation of Israel had rejected God. They had rejected God's authority. They had broken God's law. They were following after false gods and false idols. And because of that, as they were warned all the way back in Exodus, when they would walk away from God, God would allow a time of punishment, a time of chastening. So as we're reading in chapter 8, we're seeing the darkness and the depravity of what the nation is about to face because of their sin. And then we come to chapter 9, which begins with one of my favorite words in Scripture, but. Because it's this turning point. See, in the midst of the darkness and gloom of chapter 22, we come to verse 1 of chapter 9. But there will be no gloom for her who was in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he has made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. And then he bursts into this poem. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them the light has shone. You have multiplied this nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden, the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken, as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the tramping warrior in the battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. And then we come to verses 6 and 7. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end, and on the throne of David and over his kingdom to establish it and to uphold it with justice and righteousness from this time forth and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. So when we look at this passage, when we look at the passage at hand, and I'm just going to kind of set up the context of this before we start looking at the names, we see this picture of hope that's presented to a people who are about to experience dark distress, dark anguish, experiencing just a small taste of God's wrath towards the ungodly as they are about to reap the benefits, to reap the rewards of their sin against a righteous and holy and just God. And yet, in this poem that Isaiah presents, God is promising that in spite of their arrogance and pride, that he is still going to fulfill his promise to send a redeemer. He says, look, those who have walked in darkness have seen light. Those who dwell in darkness, on them light has shone. And he talks about the yoke of their burden being broken. He talks about the warrior and every garment rolled in blood being burned for the fire, the end of war, the end of anguish. And all of that hope culminates in verses 6 and 7 in the birth of a child. This child who would come, the seed of the woman, to crush the head of the serpent, as we read all the way back in Genesis chapter 3. God is declaring that he will still honor his promise. And then this Redeemer, this Messiah, is given four names, each one of them denoting an aspect of his redemptive character. We see the Wonderful Counselor, the source of wisdom and encouragement. We see the name Mighty God, source of power and authority. Everlasting Father, unending source of love and protection. And the Prince of Peace, the source of rest from their striving and from their difficulties. It says of the increase of his government of peace, there will be no end. See, Israel is about to enter a state of utter depravity. Because of their sin, because of what they have chosen to do in turning their back on God. And God says, even in the midst of this, I haven't forgotten my promise to Adam and Eve, to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, to Moses, to David. I have not forgotten my promises. And I'm still sending a redeemer, though for a time you will have to deal with the fallout of your sin and the consequences of it. one day I will send my son. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. I think so often we read these verses and we think of them simply as beautiful verses to read at Christmas. They look awful good on a Christmas card, don't they? It looks awful good when we send it to a friend or a loved one. But to remember the context of this, this is such a beautiful picture of hope in the face of a nation that's about to be almost utterly wiped out. It's a beautiful picture of God's grace. And this morning, I just want to take us just a couple of minutes to look at a couple passages to focus on this first name, the Wonderful Counselor. As I said earlier in this study that I read about, 1 in 3 Canadians desire therapy. Not desire, need. I can probably think of more than 1 in 3 Canadians that I think need therapy some days. You'll have my resignation on Monday. We're living in difficult times. We haven't heard that phrase enough. We all need counsel. Often we'll go to a friend or a loved one who we trust. We'll confide in them and we'll try to receive counsel. Some advice that we hope will point us in the right direction to deal with the issue that we're struggling with. The problem with going to man for counsel is, and as we'll see later on, is so often we may be able to go to somebody and we can maybe receive some warm advice, some helpful advice, but we can't truly always trust the motivations behind that advice, can we? And oftentimes, we may be able to receive something that seems like good and sound advice, but boy, do you got to take it with a spoonful of salt because it hurt to hear. And what we're going to see this morning is that Christ, as our wonderful counselor, through his word, through his spirit, and through the work of his people, provides us with counsel that is right, but provides us with counsel that is saturated in love and divine justice, and knowing that we can trust him with whatever our situation is. But this first name, the Wonderful Counselor, the Messiah is prophesied to be the Wonderful Counselor. That is the embodiment of the counsel of Almighty God. In Isaiah 28, verse 29, God is described as being wonderful in counsel and excellent in wisdom. And knowing that God is wonderful in counsel and excellent in wisdom, we hear here that the Messiah is to be the physical embodiment of the wisdom of God and the counsel of God. And this title, Wonderful Counselor, presents two truths about the Messiah, about Jesus Christ. First, it expresses his infinite wisdom, which I just touched on. God is excellent in wisdom and wonderful in counsel. I'm really sorry, guys. He is excellent in wisdom. He is wonderful in counsel. And the Messiah is to be the embodiment of God's wisdom. So this title, first and foremost, expresses Jesus Christ's infinite wisdom. But secondly, it expresses his divinity. Now you're probably thinking for a second, what does Wonderful Counselor have to do with the divinity of Christ? It has everything to do with the divinity of Christ, because the only one capable of being referred to as the Wonderful Counselor is God himself. I'll invite you to turn to John chapter 1. In John chapter 1, as John is writing his gospel, he is writing to a Jewish audience, and he is writing to a Greek audience. And he begins with these three words, in the beginning, which immediately piques the interest of the Jewish reader because they're thinking, oh man, we're in Genesis. We're right back at the beginning. But then John does something interesting, and he appeals to Greek philosophy. He says, in the beginning was the word. Now, the Greek word for this is logos. Logos means an expression of thought. And in Greek philosophy, your logos was the expression of who you are in your mind. So John makes this interesting statement. He says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of the world. Logos, the word, means expression of thought. And what John tells us is that Jesus Christ is Logos. He is the expression of the mind of God. He is the expression, the physical expression of the infinite wisdom and counsel of Almighty God. And then what does John say? The Word became what? Flesh. The Word became flesh and dwelled among us. The physical expression of the mind of God stepped into humanity. The infinite, eternal Son, the second member of the Godhead, stepped into humanity to be the expression, the manifestation of God's love for us. So when we call Christ Wonderful Counselor, when we say that Christ is the expression of the counsel of God, we are proclaiming his deity and his divinity. He tells us that Jesus is the physical embodiment of the mind of God, the physical expression of his thought. So when we look at Wonderful Counselor, it reveals to us the infinite wisdom of Christ, but it also reveals to us the divinity of Christ. And even more so, as we're going to discuss with Jeff next week, he is called the Mighty God. Well, this title, Wonderful Counselor, brought such hope for Israel. Think about it. In the midst of their despair, after they had been led astray by their own sinful desires, after they'd followed after kings whose counsel was anything but wise, now they're told that one is coming who will end war, who will end oppression, and his counsel will be divine. It will be divinely right, it'll be divinely righteous and holy and just, and they can trust in that. See, they had rejected God, and their leaders had rejected his wisdom, but even in their hopelessness, God promises to send a Redeemer who would rule with divine wisdom and counsel. So this title, the Wonderful Counselor, was an amazing piece of hope for them in their day as they looked forward to the coming of the Messiah. But for us here in 2023 in Parker's Cove and surrounding communities, this name brings incredible hope still. Because we know that Christ has come. He has brought God's redemption to all who will believe. And as those who have repented of our sins and turned to him in faith, this name, the Wonderful Counselor, is such a beautiful reminder. And it points us to two truths. And this is what we're going to kind of wrap up with this morning. The first truth is found in Colossians chapter 2, verses 1 through 6. And in Colossians chapter 2, verses 1 through 6, we see this, that Jesus is our source of wisdom. In Colossians chapter 2, verses 1 through 6, we read this. This is the Apostle Paul writing to the church at Colossae in the first century. He says, "For I want you to know how great a struggle I have for you and for those at Laodicea, and for all those who have not seen me face to face, that their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love to reach all the riches of full assurance of understanding and the knowledge of God's mystery, which is Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. I say this in order that no one may delude you with plausible arguments. For though I am absent in body, yet I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the firmness of your faith in Christ. Therefore, as you received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him." Let me read verse 7. "Rooted and built up in him, established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving." So in Colossians chapter 2, we see that Christ is the source of our wisdom. anything that we claim to know as believers, any aspect of wisdom that is truly from God can be found in His Word. It's found in the words of Christ, in the words of God. And in his letter to the Colossian church, Paul expresses his prayerful desire for the believers to cling to Christ's wisdom. He says, "I pray that your hearts may be encouraged, being knit together by love." And all of this is found in Christ. And I love verse 3, "in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge." How are all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge hidden in Christ? Because, as we said, he is the expressed thought of the mind of God. He is the physical embodiment of God's wisdom. Where do we find this wisdom? Is obviously in the scriptures. As we read in 2 Timothy chapter 3, all scripture is God-given and it's vital for our growth in Christ. Paul says, cling to Christ, cling to this wisdom and to this knowledge. In verse 4, he says, "I say this in order that no one may delude you." He's saying, I'm telling you this so that nobody can distract you. The Colossian church was living in a time where philosophy reigned supreme. And there was all sorts of teaching and thought that contradicted the scriptures, that contradicted God, that contradicted Christ. And Paul's saying, I don't want anybody to get you off track, so cling to the wisdom that is only found in Christ and in the scriptures. And then in verse 6, he says, therefore, as you received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him. Just as we have received Christ in faith, we follow him obediently in faith, holding on to what we are taught by the reading of his word. So this name, Wonderful Counselor, it reminds us that our source of wisdom is in Christ, and that there is such encouragement for our hearts to be found in the full assurance of understanding of who Christ is. And the second truth that this points us to is that Jesus Christ is the source of our comfort in the midst of difficulty, in the midst of calamity, in the midst of circumstances that are so much less than ideal for us. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, and I'll invite you to turn there to 2 Corinthians chapter 1, in verses 3 through 5, in the opening verses of this letter, we see a beautiful illustration of God's comforting love through Christ. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, 3 and 5, we read this. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our affliction, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. For as we share abundantly in Christ's sufferings, so through Christ we share abundantly in comfort too. Paul says, blessed be God, the God of all comfort. But notice what he says, who comforts us in, we're going to come back to that word, in all of our affliction. For what purpose? So that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction. You see, Christ comforts us in our affliction as we subject ourselves to his word and to prayer. And he does so in order that we may comfort those around us who are struggling. How often do we, I'll say sinfully and arrogantly, ask the question, why me? Right? How often do we think, what is the purpose of this in my life? Sometimes the things that happen to us are of no fault of our own. How often is the sin of somebody else impacting so many countless others? We deal with affliction. Notice that God's promise is not to remove affliction from our existence or to spare us from affliction, but rather we're told that we get to share in the afflictions of Christ. I'm having a hard time wrapping my head around that. I had a dear friend who when we would minister together, his mantra was this: we don't have to do this, we get to do this. Now, that's all well and good until he's talking about, you know, like cleaning up teenager throw up from a toilet at camp, right? And I'm thinking, ugh, we got to go clean the bathrooms again. And he would say, no, we don't have to clean the bathrooms. We get to do this. We get to partner with Christ in his afflictions. Now, scrubbing a toilet is not afflictions. If that's your affliction, man alive, you have it really good, okay? But we go through difficulties in life. We struggle with loss, with anxiety, with frustrations. Sometimes it's the outflow of our sin. Other times it's the outflow of others' sin. Doesn't matter what the source of it is, the reality is that we're all going to deal with affliction today, in this day. But the believer is not promised absence from suffering, but rather we're promised comfort even in the midst of our most difficult circumstances. And what is the purpose? So that as brothers and sisters in Christ, we can come alongside each other with a loving arm and not say, I totally understand where you've been. Because nobody understands what's going on in the heart and the mind of somebody else. But we can say, you know what? We have a wonderful counselor. We have one who provides comfort in our distress through his word, through his spirit, and through his people. He wants to, he desires to use us as the instrument of encouragement in the lives of those around us. I want us to think about that during this Christmas season. We all know folks who are struggling. We all know folks who are dealing with loss or frustration this time of year. How incredible would it be if we allowed God to use us to be the instrument of encouragement for our neighbor, for our brother and sister in Christ, to come alongside and to say, hey, I'm praying for you. The wonderful counselor's got your back. I don't know what's going on in your life. I don't claim to understand what's going on in your life. I may not even be able to help what's going on in your life. But I've got your back because Christ has ours. Who comforts us in all our afflictions so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction. We're promised comfort even in the midst of our most difficult circumstances. In the book of Hebrews, we're reminded that in Christ, we have an intercessor who is in every respect able to sympathize with us. It says we do not have a high priest who is unable to associate with us, but one who has been tempted in every respect but without sin. And it's because of that that the author of Hebrews says we can come boldly to the throne of grace to receive help in our time of need. When's our time of need? It was about 30 seconds ago for me. It was about 2 seconds ago for me. It was about 1 second ago for me. It's constant. Our need for Christ doesn't stop. We may, in our perception, think we're doing okay, but if you think that you are without need for Christ, I have a bridge to sell you. The reality is that because Christ can sympathize with our affliction, Jesus knows better than anyone what it's like to feel rejection, to feel loss, to feel exhaustion, to feel frustration. But you want to know something? He feels all of those things as man, but as God, he is the Almighty God who can do something about those things. We're told that we do not have an intercessor who can't sympathize with us, but one who does in every respect. And because of that, we can come to the throne of grace. See, only our wonderful counselor can truly provide us with the grace that we need to withstand the difficulties of life. As we continue on through this Christmas season, today we're reflecting on the wonderful counselor. Next week we'll reflect on the mighty God. And I'm looking forward to Jeff sharing. But my prayer for us this Christmas season is that we would celebrate the season with hope. And I know that seems so cliche, but I'm not just talking about this hope that looks far to the future, this hope that looks forward to what Christ is going to do. But I want that hope to impact how we live today, knowing that the wonderful counselor sympathizes with our deepest hurt and desires to instruct us through his word on how to honor and glorify God even in the midst of our deepest suffering, and how to be an encouragement to those within the body of Christ. Christmas is about hope. The hope of salvation as God stepped into humanity to show us love and to make a way for forgiveness and redemption. Scripture tells us that this wonderful counselor is always here with infinite wisdom for each and every circumstance. But I want to leave us with this. It's not only wisdom, but it's love and comfort. There is no greater comfort than the comfort that God can give, because only God can give it. We can go to the world for counsel.